Buenos días a todos y todas. Bienvenidos y bienvenidas al webinario 3 en el marco del proyecto INNOVAT. Es un gusto tenerles acá con nosotros una vez más en esta serie de webinarios. Y yo tengo mucho gusto de darles a todos y todas la bienvenida hoy día. Mi nombre es Lidia Pascualín. Para los que todavía no me conocen, soy la coordinadora del proyecto INNOVAT desde la Universidad FH Ioneum de Austria. Así que hoy día vamos a tener el webinario que va a ser liderado por nuestras socias de la Universidad Breda de Ciencias Aplicadas en Holanda. Nuestras compañeras Lilia y Margot van a estar hoy día acompañándonos en ese webinario. Les comento una vez más que como en los otros webinarios, contamos con la ayuda y moderación de compañeros y compañeras de cada universidad de Chile y Perú. Así que les pido a nuestros queridos socios de Chile y Perú, responsables por moderación, que nos ayuden hoy día, una vez que ese webinario será dictado en inglés, pero con las diapositivas en español y con la moderación también en español. Así que es posible que puedan rescatar las preguntas más relevantes de su universidad y hacer un resumen, y si posible ya en inglés, para que podamos contestar al decorrer de la presentación. Los certificados, a los que requieren certificados, al final del webinario también vamos a compartir el enlace para que soliciten los certificados del webinario 3. Así que ya de mi parte creo que es suficiente porque tenemos muchas cosas buenas que escuchar hoy día respecto a la interacción en línea y también en el aula con los alumnos y cómo hacerla más motivadora y bastante así como entusiasmante y bastante efectiva. Así que es un gusto pasar a la palabra a Lilia Tercieva de la Universidad Breda. Bienvenida, Lilia.
Hello, hello everyone from my side as well. So glad to see you all. Although I cannot physically see you, I can feel already this great kind of vibration of all these people joining this webinar. So let me start with some little surprise. Hola a todos. Nosotros de la Universidad de Breda de Ciencias Aplicadas de Holanda estamos más que encantados de ser los anfitriones del webinario número 3 de INNOVAT sobre interacción. Bienvenidos todos. Es un gran placer y un honor. Por favor, tengan paciencia con nosotros, ya que estaremos hablando en inglés, por lo que tratemos de interactuar y aprender juntos. Gracias. Having said that, it is of course time to move to our webinar and to see what can it bring to us when it comes to interaction. So the most important is first to start with a short introduction. And I think since Lidia shared the slides, so then maybe she's the only one that can move them now for me. So please, maybe Lidia, you can kindly go to the next slide, please. Otherwise, I can take over.
And Lilia, it seems that I cannot change this. Can you change it then directly?
I will do that. I will stop sharing for a moment. And then I will do that. Yes, as you can see, certain things are always possible to happen. So let's see whether now it will move. It is moving. Perfect. So welcome once again. Who we are. You can see here my colleague, Marjo Royakers, and myself, and we both are in a situation that is far more pleasant than being just online. But with this, we would like to say we always believe in the way that we can interact together, and we always believe that we can bring something closer to success if we would do it together. So this is also a webinar that we would kindly ask you to think beyond just the regular and try to experiment with more. Everything that is now happening would have been impossible without the great support of our Innovat team. As you can see here, this was our last offline meeting of the consortium partners. And with all of that, we were able to now bring ourselves even to webinars that can summon more than 300 people together. And this only makes us proud. And I would like to also, together with Marjo and together with the rest of the team, thank all co-moderators of all the different webinars that help us go through this challenge together. And a special gratitude goes to Oriana. She is a professor at the university in Chile, and she has been the one constantly next to us, bringing this content closer to you and translating it in Spanish. What we will be doing today, in short, the agenda. These are basically the 6 points that we will try to guide you through. The first one will be the world of the adult learner, something that we sometimes believe we know well, but it somehow happens that we try to not forget things, and certainly they remain at the back of our mind, deeply forgotten. Let's try to put them outside, out there, a little bit closer. Then we will look into the essence and relevance of interaction in education. Why does it matter? Why is it so important to actually communicate, receive feedback, get motivation of everything that we are doing? We will look into the ways of how students learn. And as you can see, at some points, we will also go back to you and ask, are there any specific questions? Is there something pending that you would like to express now, even if this would be possible only via the Q&A? We will, of course, give you some tips, tricks, experiences, and examples of what we currently do online and how everything that we used to do offline not so long ago, we moved towards a blended, or more to say, very much online scenario. And at the end, we will try to summarize together to get some insights, and we will leave time for pending questions. But please feel free to share everything that you would like to make as a remark or pose as a question that we can address even later. What already Ligia mentioned, but I would like to pinpoint to, is even if the time, because time is never sufficient, and of course the topic of the fourth webinar will be about time, but please, because time is really scarce, if there is something that you would like to very much discuss and you would like to kindly ask us to respond to, we will do that even after the webinar. Just make sure the question appears in the Q&A line and it will get back to you with hopefully an answer. And we do not believe we have all the answers, but we will at least give you our perspective towards that. So let me start now with the first item on the agenda, and that is the world of the adult learner. And as wise people say, we have to really all the time be creative. Why so? Because if we are not leaving our comfort zone on a daily basis and taking steps into the unknown, then we have never lived. And let's try to take this as a motto. And I still remember kind of the questions resonated with us that were coming from the first and the second webinar, where you posed the question, how about students' respect towards the teacher? Is the teacher not losing face when he or she has to experiment with a new tool and coming closer to interaction? But isn't this exactly the process of learning and of opening up a little bit more towards the possibilities of today? So maybe exposing ourselves, showing ourselves a little bit more vulnerable, brings us closer to who we are, and the students can only appreciate that and not make fun of us or show a different image of the teacher than we want us to pursue. What we would like you to kindly keep at the back of your minds is also something very specific when it comes to adult learning. And adult learning happens in higher education, because we have to be aware that when we say adults, we mean people above 16. So anyone being above 16, and these are the people who go to our higher educational institutions, are adults. So there are specific principles about the adult learning and what we can offer in higher education. We will look together now at the six specific characteristics of the adult learners and why is it sometimes so difficult and why are they not so obedient as we wish them to be sometimes, or at least some sort of more empathic and empathetic towards specific situations. We will then look into their special needs. What are the special needs of these adult learners? And we need to know, in what way do they learn best? What is it, especially through interaction, that we can do for them a bit better? When we talk about adults and adult learners, we shouldn't be forgetting these six characteristics. They are far more autonomous. They are self-directed, and even if we very well know with the experiences that we have so far collected, that sometimes they do believe they are autonomous, but they are far from it yet, we have to give them a little bit more respect. They need it. We have to also give them as much as possible practice. And sometimes, and we will see that online might be a challenge, but still there is a notion of opportunity. They are very much go-oriented. We can see that. You saw it last time with all these fantastic tools that Carlos and Carlos provided to us as an overview. It was not an ocean. It was kind of a hilarious volcano of possible tools. How we can actually collaborate and how much closer now online we become to their world and why they become actually passionate about the online, because this is their world and they need to have a foundation of life experiences and knowledge to continue further. So these are very specific characteristics that we need to take into account when it comes to education and specifically higher one. And something that I would like you to also kindly be reminded of, and I'm sure most of you know, what we are doing in higher education is not pedagogy. What we are doing is andragogy. And it is a very special word that comes from ancient Greek. And it is actually about leading people, not leading children as pedagogy is, but leading people. And if we in higher education are the ones able to shape and to lead these people in a world which needs to become only one step better, only tiny little bit more perfect towards what we are aiming, then we have been achieving our goals. Again, together, listening to their sometimes silent voices. What is also important to take into account, because we talk now, especially having said that, about these specific characteristics of these adult learners, especially about these ways of sharing with them the responsibility of learning, knowledge, and also perceptions, there should be some kind of a strategy of active learning. And this strategy leaves learning not as a spectator sport. It is not something that can only go one direction. It is the more actively we manage to engage the learner, the more learning it actually takes place. And there are plenty of different instructional methodologies that have greater rates of retention. The earlier we are able to show the learner that the one that is kind of penetrated with the knowledge that we are giving, that this is helping him or her, then the more they will be able to achieve their goals and the more interested they will become in what we are providing. And that, of course, requires a new role from us. That requires us to move to actually at least 16, if I'm now trying to explain about them in detail, which reminds me to also here give a little bit of promotion to our MOOC that already Ligia and Carlos in the first and in the second webinar spoke so highly of. And we do believe that there you will be able to find already in the first module these specifics of these new educators we are becoming. And one of the most important roles of that is the role of the facilitator, the one who is able into this amazing world full of challenges and opportunities to make life a little bit easier, to show how simplification does not mean underestimating the value of the knowledge and expertise we have created, but it shows some shortcuts in a network which otherwise would be extremely difficult for each and every student. Then going to the essence of facilitation, if there could be any essence, because it is so much rich into these multifaceted experiences that when we are explaining about it. And yes, facilitation is about helping people themselves, you know, not us giving it and them doing it, but themselves by designing social processes for new mindsets about the topic, new perspectives, new opportunities and new curiosity. That is actually about creating a mindset that is specific towards a specific passion. And yes, the ultimate goal is to create a group culture and a group structure, because we are social beings. And although we live in times that highly request from us to be now physically distant, which means to a certain extent very much socially distant, we still belong and we need these interaction patterns that can construct for the future a group society and a world that is far more connected than it has ever been before. Having said that, I would like us to move to the essence and relevance of interaction and education. Why this topic? Why in this webinar we have decided, taking into account the specifics of the adult learner, the changing roles of the educators today, and the higher education complexity, to look into interaction? Let me share with you. First and very important aspect is interaction in higher education is not just between the teachers and the students. It's not just between the teachers, the professors themselves. It is also with the industry. It is with the alumni. It is with the diverse stakeholders and administration involved. So again, it is multi-level and multifaceted. And all of that requires our attention as teachers, because we are basically interacting with all these key players, and we have to have these key specific competences to help us swim and dance, because I hope you remember my metaphor of the first webinar. Interaction is also a dance in higher education that we are trying to do to its utmost perfection when it comes. Sometimes it might be a tango, sometimes it might be very slow, and sometimes it might be individual when we are trying to detect the specific opportunities for each and every student. And having said that, let me move on to something very interesting when it comes to interaction. The times have changed, not only for higher education, for organizations in general. Why so? What we used to call, not longer than 30 years ago, a one-way stream, a one direction of teaching, of knowledge transmission, is no longer valid only. What we have to also say, and that is a very important remark I would like to also make. When we talk about these new worlds and these new changes, this doesn't mean that the new kills the old. No, we talk about worlds that will coexist together forever. The world of the one-way transmission would still be needed, because as teachers, we know that there is knowledge which is needed to be transmitted in a specific way. You had a question before, how do we teach engineering when we need laboratory experiments, when we need offline work? How can we do that online? Is it really possible, even if we would have the ideal software, to experience what we are actually experiencing in engineering? So you're seeing it very clearly. Then the next world we moved on to, and I hope you remember what Professor Carlos Delgado last time was discussing with you, starting from where we were into the evolution of the computer, the artificial intelligence and more. So in the second point, the world second point, there was the first time interaction. We were not just interested into the message that we are sending. We were finally interested in receiving feedback and into processing these messages and kind of developing them, amending them, and improving them together. But what we have moved nowadays towards, keeping in mind that still the 1.0 and 2.0 coexist into what we do, we have moved to a network. And this is a very special network, because in a network of education, the teacher has not only the central role, the teacher can be also just part of a system that someone else might know better. A different source might be best to be used, even though this might be not the expertise of the teacher, him or herself, then the student takes the role of facilitating. Then the industry becomes the teacher, and we are together weaving these pathways of a new future. So yes, the times have changed. Connectivity, collectivity, co-creation, and all these beautiful words starting with C are now clearly depicting the world of higher education as well, and the way that we need to interact in order for every student and for every learner to accommodate to the knowledge needed for this specific society. And yes, what is it then, interaction? What is its essence? What is important to be said? Interaction is a very special phenomenon, if I may say. It is kind of an action that always requires two or more, in which people or objects or some kind of subjects that affect one another. The more effect is being achieved into this interaction, the more there is a possibility in actually understanding these two-way or multi-way effects that we are able to see in education. And you can see that this is how it actually happens, even on this picture. It wouldn't be just us as teachers. It wouldn't be just the computer as an open source information. It wouldn't be any content coming from outside or social circles. It would be anything that can teach us to move better into a world that requests and requires from us far more than it has ever done. Then, how do students learn, if I may move to this one? In what way is it better for any student nowadays to learn as much as we want him or her to do? And to do so, of course, there are three important elements that we have already in one way or another referred to in the other two webinars. Students of today, adult learners of today, love to play, as we all do. Although we grow older, we do not lose this passion when somebody says we are going to do a play. We are going to do something different together. The enthusiasm, the sparkle in their eyes is already there. Whether it will be by means of a role play, whether it will be by a serious game, whether it will be just Lego that we are going to create and build something together of. But it is this kind of involvement and interaction that actually leaves traces that cannot be easily removed from the minds and the embodiment that the students do with their knowledge. At the same time, the students always need of today, the students of today and the students of tomorrow hopefully will need to do more in quizzes, to do more in case studies, to imagine themselves into as many as possible real life situations, and not only imagine, hopefully also be placed in such situations when it comes to some kind of placements, apprenticeships, internships, or simply graduation projects. And last but not least, they love to act. Whether this will be in simulations, whether this will be in participatory discussions where they need to make a point, to learn how to negotiate, to present and express themselves in an articulated way, all of that is a way for them to actually learn today better. And why so? Because we are living in a world that is moving towards creating value differently. There is a specific shift in value creation. We are moving away, although we still stay very closely connected, we are moving more from the machine way of thinking to the organism, living organism way of thinking. Yes, we bring them again closer, as I mentioned, with the world 1.0, 2.0, etc. These are all worlds that co-create together. But then, into this new world and new understandings of where we live, we all want to be participants. We don't want to be simple consumers and receivers. We want to have our voice heard. And this is also the voice of the student. And we know that if you look into revolution and evolution, then you would always see that the knowledge wisdom bringers were the ones who were defending evolution, whereby the ones who were creating the revolutions were always the students, the inquisitive and curious-minded people. So yes, we need to cope more with a proactive rather than with a reactive behavior. Even if you look into today's crisis of where it brings us, in any sector and in any field, this proactive behavior is the one that more or less brings us closer again to achievements, to success, to innovation, and to more creation. And yes, I would like to also give you a little bit of the characteristics of the VUCA world, because the VUCA world is the world we are living in, and specifically doing that with all these students, with all these people, and with everyone around us. This world is volatile. This world is uncertain. This world is very complex and ambiguous. And if I may summarize that in only two sentences, I need to say that volatile means knowledge is outdated very quickly. We cannot go to a doctor who hasn't been studying all the time until we got to him and he prescribed us a medicine. We would never trust a doctor who stopped studying and learning a year ago, right? And that is valid for each and every profession. We are uncertain. We do not know what the conclusion or what the outcome of something specific will be. And this is also the spirit we would need to give our students. How do we assess formative or summative? Does it matter whether we assess more the outcome or we assess more the process? In an uncertain world, definitely we go more towards processes. And when we talk about complex, I will have a little bit of an explanation, just bear with me. Just the ambiguous, we always have a different perspective. As you can see, also because of the time difference, for you it's just early morning, for us it's almost late afternoon, but we are still together and we see this perspective differently. We have a different view onto the sun that is just having a different position now. And can you imagine what that means when it comes to education? Having said that, and now of course something blocked. Let me go back. Let me go here. Yeah, in the meantime, I will also refer maybe to the next slide. When we talk about the VUCA world, I said there was also one characteristic that I would like you to be aware of, and that is the characteristic of someone who is always able to see things in their fullest, in their systems approach. And when this is the case, then it is much easier to go and interpret it with a nice posture and with a nice view on that. When talking about problems that we face, we usually face three types of problems. The problems which are very simple, a flat tire, we don't like it, but we cope with it. We know how to fix it, even with closed eyes, a broken window. We cope also with complicated problems. They're not as easy as the simple ones. For example, sending a man to the moon is far more complicated than just fixing a flat tire. But the moment we have the recipe, then we have it all. Then we can repeat it as many times as need be, and then everything will go accordingly. But when it comes to complex problems, is it that much easier to actually go along? No, because complex problems require not one solution. They require a contextual way of looking at things and finding ways that we would be able to do only if we take the system in its fullest. So therefore, it is very important to distinguish all those. And now I'm going to connect, hopefully, the slides once again and then give the floor to my colleague Marco. So, just if you bear with me for a moment, then I'll be able to hopefully share them, and then it will be fine. Okay. Yes, Marco is there. Now we need to go to the right slide and we will continue.
Thank you, Lydia. We arrived at four tips and tricks regarding interaction, and we will show some examples from our daily practice as teacher, or maybe I should say as facilitator of learning processes. And let's start with a Chinese proverb that's very famous, but that's very applicable to education nowadays. And that states, tell me and I will forget, show me and I may remember, involve me and I will understand. And that's exactly what we're talking about here. So it's all about involving your students, interact with them, and also get them engaged and motivated. And of course, saying this is so much more easier than actually doing it. We all realize that it's necessary, but putting it into practice is really a different story. Because as Lily already said, you need to get out of your comfort zone and you need to give away control. And it's not always easy to just trust the process and see where it goes. But even in these times, it's even more necessary because of the difficult times we're in with the coronavirus. And if I may have the next slide, please, Lilia. We had to switch suddenly from offline education to completely online education. And here in the Netherlands, we're already doing that for now already 2 months or over 2 months. And probably it's almost the same with you. And of course, the first reaction is always to try to do online the same as you do offline. But already very soon you notice that online and offline teaching is not the same. Online teaching is much more intense for students as well as for the teachers. And online education has a higher risk of cognitive overload. And furthermore, as I may speak of my own experience, online education makes it easier for students to take the passive role and just consume education. They come online, but put their cameras off and their mic off, and then it's up to you to interact and get them going. And that's of course not what education is about. Education is about students taking the driver's seat and actively steering their own learning journey. And to prevent students from leaning backwards, taking this back seat, it's preferable not to just give long lectures, but to divide your lessons in blocks of different activities, because by diversification, it is easier to keep the attention of students and it prevents you from only sending information. And then in what sort of activity blocks can we think? We can make a distinction between five activity blocks, and you can see them on the slide. So first there is instruction, in which the teacher gives an assignment to the students and explains how to do it. The second block is knowledge transfer, and that is when the teacher gives new information to the students, either via PowerPoint with audio or via knowledge clip or without anything that's supported. Then the third block is work independently, so you can let your students work on an assignment either individually or in subgroups. Next one is brainstorm, that is when you want to have a creative session with your students and collect new input from them and together with them. And the last one is the reflection and Q&A block. And in this block, you can reflect on the assignment that they made, and you can discuss the outcomes, or you can check whether the knowledge transfer, your new knowledge, whether they understood it correctly, or whether there are still questions that need to be answered. And of course, you can combine all these blocks in numerous ways to get the best suitable roadmap for your lesson. And that's what you can see on this slide. There are four examples of different combinations of activity blocks. And for instance, in example two, that's the most simple roadmap. You start with knowledge transfer, new knowledge. Then you have a block of reflection to see if the knowledge came through or whether there are questions. And you end with working independently on an assignment. either individually or in subgroups, and then you have the whole roadmap. And there are many, many options. Maybe Lilia, you can take over to illustrate this approach with an example from your practice.
Yes, Marco, thank you. I will pick it up from here and I will try to, yeah. Why is it stuck every time we move a person? That is also something that technology can do to you. And that is also the way that you can expose yourself once we started in the beginning with. So never lose power and never lose sense of making also jokes of yourself. So as you can see now, even if this happens, we will simply go back, we will try to reactivate it, and hopefully it will run properly again. But you can never trust technology as much as you can trust a living human being. That is also something which we need to take for the future much more respectively, if possible. Having said that, I would again go back to sharing it differently, and then it should allow me to do it properly, hopefully. Yes. An example of what Margot just referred to, of all these combinations of different activities that you can offer to your students. And this is the first thing that I would like to show you out of many more examples that also Margot will continue in a moment with. This is a lecture in innovation and change, which usually was supposed to take 2 hours with just with the presence of the students, but had to now be moved to an online version. What actually happened that there 7 days before the lecture itself, there was a pre-recording of the lecture in 4 videos, which consisted of 15 minutes each. And then they were provided to the students to watch. 3 days before the lecture took place, or actually the moment when the students and the teacher got together, there were some teasers in the format of videos via YouTube, a mural, a canvas on Mural, which the students had to collaborate on. And then the interaction actually that happened online was no longer a lecture. There was an organization of the agenda that was shown to the students with some energizers, exercises in breakout rooms of either via channels on Teams or via Zoom breakout rooms, some reflection again on what they have done, refreshing the content that you shared in advance in some sort of 15 minutes note more, exercise again in a different group composition, reflection again, and questions, questions, questions that you refer to, because now they have far more being advanced into the content provided, and closing and reflection coming from the students on how you did on content processing, the interaction. And as you can see already here, that required far more time for every teacher to prepare for. And when I myself was actually doing that, it took me much longer, but then the value of what had been achieved was much bigger. So yes, sometimes people may say Corona was really a disaster, but in these instances, when it comes to education and more interaction, it can be called a blessing. So I would like to now give you in a very short format some ideas of energizers that you can do either online or offline. The idea behind that is, why do we do that? Every time you get a group together, no matter whether it is online or offline, you need to get their attention, you need to get their focus. Whether you will start with a Kahoot quiz, whether you would do something with a Mentimeter, you want them involved. You want there to be energy, some fun, some people to smile, some people to make jokes and mock of each other's, a clear start. Where do we stand? And of course, experience. We need to embody that, as we say. Education is no longer only connected to the mind. It's also connected to the heart and to the soul of how we experience that. Via these different energizers that I'm going to shortly present a little bit in a roller coaster style snowball effect, there are general tips to create a comfortable space, everybody to feel closer to what you shall be doing after, to use storytelling, to really guide them by the hand, to explain what you have done after there was an exercise, to really see the reasoning behind why you do what you do. And then when needed to reflect, to take the time, it takes time, yes, and it is not an easy process, but the more we learn to reflect, not only on the bad elements, but also on the good elements, we start to actually realize more. There is an interesting tip and trick that I would like to give with this one. The exercise is called I Do Art. And it is actually very interesting because every time you would start something with a group of people, up to 40 or a bit more even, you can do that as really sharpening the meeting and this online or offline moment you will be having with your students. You can position that as the professors last time in webinar 2 showed us with the Padlet. You can really precise that furthermore if you would do it later on into another tool, or even just do it, of course, with physical presence. And the idea behind is the following. These are actually what the abbreviation of I Do Art stands for. Having a clear intention, what will be the desired outcomes and agreeing upon them, the agenda that everybody would follow, the roles and the rules of how this online or offline interaction is going to happen, and of course, managing the time. What will be included, what kind of breaks, and at what time this meeting or this class or this online session will be coming to an end. Very useful, and if every moment you start with it, the more you do on online interaction, the more you will see how much focus and energy are already brought to the classroom experiences, no matter whether they are now mostly online. The next one is another tip and trick into A or B, and this is a very interesting one. It's more of a game. You can, without saying anything in advance, just ask the students to choose from two words, winter or summer, green or red, spikes or softness, tennis rockets or balls. And at the end, when they have written what they have written in terms of wording, you can see them fully frustrated. But the idea was to collect the words to go to a Christmas tree. Can you imagine? But if you have explained them in advance, how much more they have actually been able to get out of that, and what not if there is no proper explanation. And this is very important for each and every class to really see and set the ground for what the achievement, the learning objective, learning goal, or learning outcome can be. Another one that Marco is also going to refer shortly after me about check-ins and check-outs and daily check-ins and check-outs is something that is very important. Again, in order for us to get towards the idea, what does this group need? Where does it stand? How much time does it have to be spent? What to actually reflect upon? Where would we like to get the knowledge being driven and the experiences? And this can be done by many different ways, by some reflective questions, by presenting yourself at the beginning of the online session, for example, as an animal or as a car because of the mood you're in and the outcome that you would like to get out of the classroom. And it can be also very much into how do you see yourself, the expectations and the contributions you would like to do to that specific classroom activity. The next one refers to interviewing and introducing. How beautiful it would be if in each and every interaction, and that can be achieved very easily online, we do it now almost regularly either via Zoom or Teams or the Google class chats, etc., that or sometimes even via Blackboard, some colleagues, that you could see this intervision happening between two or more students to interview one another, to introduce then each other's points of views and perspectives, to simply put themselves into the shoes of understanding far more because of not only seeing it yourself in your tunnel vision. And also another one is the closing. And this is not an energizer, but this is actually a very important time that we sometimes, because of being in a rush, kindly cut too short. And the closing is really this kind of teaser for us to continue, because we can imagine very well as being educators in this new world and also in the old world, in the classroom, in the online activities, in the offline activities, we are just the teaser. The next step is for the student to be made. And therefore, we need to create this pathway of motivation for them to say, okay, we go for it, and we need more, and we are curious for more, and we need to talk about that. We shouldn't be leaving that open. And that very much relates to also this exercise, which is called the gift giving. And that is something that we usually tend to kind of neglect in education, to give each other's compliments, to support one another in a difficult and challenging process. And if we would do that with a simple A4 at the back of each and every one of us, we can even do that in hidden channels, even in the poll everywhere that we saw last time as a very interesting tool brought up by UC3M. Yes, and then we would look into all these kind of energy that has been generated because of what we do as teachers, of what the students have contributed to the process, and how they can actually continue it and take it further. Having said that, I would like again to give the floor to Marjo, who is now going to bring you some interesting input onto that specifics. Let me bring her now on, and then together with the content, and then it should be fine.
Thank you, Maria.
You're more than welcome.
We now want to present several ways in which we try to incorporate interaction in our own teaching context. Lilia and I are both teaching at the Master of Engineering here in Breda, and we chose to present 5 examples that you can see on the slide. And we chose for these ones not because they're the only ones, we have many possibilities for interaction, but because they are all different. Some focus on interaction between students themselves or students and lecturers, while others focus on interaction or also include interaction with alumni or industry partners. And if I may have the next slide, Lilia, I want to start with the daily starter and the daily wrap-up. We developed that one because we had a course of 8 weeks in which we had many guest lecturers involved, and some for half a day, some for the whole day. And students really loved the content, but they had trouble with seeing the bigger picture. So how all these topics were connected. And we found out during the roundtable when we got the evaluation back. And we thought how to prevent this next time. So we had, of course, several options. The first maybe option that comes to mind is to write down the explicit red threads in the study guide. But we chose not to do so. We chose we decided to let students discover this red thread themselves and to support them with that. So the next time we started each day with a daily starter, and we ended it with a daily wrap-up session, each of 15 minutes, and we let students be in the lead. So the students, a duo of students, were the facilitators. And this duo then checked whether all sources were read, whether there were questions that needed to be tackled that day. They checked how this topic related to the topics that were already that they already had in the previous weeks, etc. And then the class would follow, and then at the end they would have a reflection session also on the same topics to see whether everything was clear and what the red thread was. And actually that worked out very well. Maybe we can see the impression on the next slide, Lilia. Thank you. I forgot to tell that, but both sessions, so the morning session and the closing session, were not in the class setting, but in the back of the class. We had two nice sofas, and it was more an informal gathering, and people could have a coffee, etc. And that also added to the atmosphere and the inspiration that they had. Students were also very happy with the session because it supported their individual learning journey, but also their collective learning journey. So they learned from each other. As a supervisor, you could stand back and only interfere when it was really necessary. Maybe I can have the next slide, Lilia. Thank you for the lessons learned. As said, we were really happy with the results because the learning process was so much richer, and even the guest lecturers, they wanted to join because for them it was also very helpful to see the interaction between the students and the communication around their topic. So that was one example. The next example is our annual book review event. One of the assignments that students have to carry out is to do a book review. And students can normally choose out of a collection of 9 books that we select, 3 books on 3 general themes. And instead of having them present this in their own class to each other, we make an event out of it. And students can invite friends or family, and we invite some colleagues and some alumni. They are, of course, familiar with the event, and they like to come back to the Institute and to strengthen the bonds. And we also invite the stakeholders from the industry. And we had a new director, and this year we also invited him to meet our students. And the event itself consists of 3 workshops in which the 3 books are presented. And we ask the students to make this workshop an experience. So they have to collaborate together and see the connecting topics between the books and then come up with an experience. So there are several preparation sessions to go with that. And maybe we can see the impression, Lilia, from this year. These are 2 photos of the book review session this year. And this is always a really nice event because it's a great way to link the students with the industry and also to strengthen the bonds with the alumni. Next slide, please. Thank you. And students find it really a rewarding assignment, and we see that they invest lots of time and energy in it, and they really like to make the whole event a success. So in that way, it is also an success. We already have it on our agenda for many years. If you want to see whether you can do, oh, sorry, just one back, please. Yes, because if you, of course, both events or both examples were done offline, but you can also look on how to do it, transform it to an online event, because probably this year, next year, we need to do it online. And for the book review event, maybe we would sort of go for a different option and ask students to deliver the knowledge clips on their books and then make them available for the audience and have some online interaction on that. So it needs to be transformed a bit. And then for the third example, we chose for our hackathon. Well, what is a hackathon? It's for us, it's a 3-day deep dive in which students tackle assignments that they get from case owners, from the industry, organizations that are looking for innovations, that they have a real life problem that they want their students to, to get their hands on. And it's sort of a pressure cooker setting of 3 days, and students explore the challenges and have creative sessions and then work towards suggestions for improvement. Maybe I can have the next visualization of the hackathon. Thank you. In the bottom right corner, you see the program for the hackathon. So we start with the pitches from the case owners. Then we have a collective brainstorm. And in the afternoon, if possible, students go to visit the company and get a guided tour through the organization. And then the second day, it's mostly hack away. And the third day as well. And then in the afternoon, we end with a marketplace where all student groups present their innovative solutions. And if I may have the impression slide, here you see an impression from already 2 years ago, I think 2 or 3 years ago, where the students are busy with the creative process. And if we then go to the lessons learned, we can see that this is a really good event because students are really motivated by the real life assignments that they get from the case owners, from the industry, and this pressure cooker setting of the 3 days on a different setting with just one focus, that's really good for student engagement. It's really a nice mix of education and fun. And what's always nice for us is that students always succeed in surprising the case owners. So throughout the years, we learned to trust this process and trust the outcomes that the students are able to come up with. Thinking about online versus offline, we're already preparing to do this online for next study year. We already have been checking all sorts of online hackathons, and it is possible, but of course dynamics will be different. Then back to you, Lilia, then you can take us through the last two examples.
Yes, thank you very much, Marco. Yes, so we will be now moving to the next few examples. Hopefully, yeah, again, when we are changing, there is something happening. So I really hope it will allow me not to do that. Yes, so the next example is about the online research course that we now very much embraced, because when everything happened, what happened? We had to do something differently when it came to their final graduation project of our students. And research, as we all know, is not kind of the first passion of all of our 100% students. So for us, it was really very important to not have this even heavier burden on the shoulders of our students and to really assist them as much as possible when they work on their individual assignments for their companies. In our case, we call them application companies, where they realize their projects with a real life organization. So yeah, doing it online makes it a little bit harder, even more than what they were expecting. But therefore, we introduced on a weekly basis next to the online research course, which was, yeah, kind of made very much in a speed, still with a very good quality, with all the clips necessary. And most of what they had to already receive, they had received, but still to have something as a hidden weapon for them to continue, we added these weekly online support meetings. And they were organized by the lead person in our research. This is the research coordinator for all students in their graduation trajectory, but also all the different research coaches, supervisors were invited, and thus as well alumni when available, so that they can discuss onto their projects. What was really very interesting, how this happened and what kind of support did they get? This session is usually in between an hour and a half, and it takes the form of a voluntary Q&A moment in which all the students bring their own challenges. Then we group along and we discuss them with different students, with the coordinators, with the coaches, so that they receive a very much richer perspective. It is no longer the student and their own thesis trajectory. It is the student with the richness of a whole journey that all our students are taking along together with the research coaches. Yes, a very proactive attitude is being expected from the students. For example, if there is a specific question on a specific method or tool, research tool to be used, then the student takes the responsibility to present what he or she makes sense out of that and can create sometimes a knowledge clip if need be in a small video, and then everyone goes along and interprets what this means for the respective research of the student. Here you can see some of the examples of us meeting together, also a mural that for a student was very interesting to bring along when it comes to community building, using also the images of the three little piglets, which I'm sure you know as a fairy tale. So all of that we try to bring in together, even online. What we have also learned is also something really spectacular. We would like to bring these online research talks, as we call them, also to an offline version, if we ever go to an only offline version, because this is really showing this value of the weekly opportunity to discuss all these problems, to have the presence of all the rest of the students and the lecturers, to support one another, meaning the students, and to learn from each other as well as the coaches. And the students value very much in this time the opportunity to reconnect to their mates, to their colleagues, and to reconnect to their lecturers. So there is always a session with these energizers or some of them that we mentioned. Always we do differently. What is also very interesting for those online moments is that we never use only one tool. We sometimes use Teams, we sometimes use Zoom, and every time a different student will be in the lead of facilitation. So like this, we have also used the Google Chat, etc. So for us, and always Mural, Miro, Padlet, or any other tool that can come handy for that situation the student has chosen for. The next element that we would like to show, and actually this is the last one of these experiences we have had so far, is the heydays. Heydays, as we call them, these are strategic heydays, or this is a so-called annual event where the program that we are running, the curriculum, is being reviewed together with the coordinator of the program, the whole team around the program, which is inside and outside the organization, of course, management, students, and alumni. And it's in the past, it was just in the form of these amazing 2 days on a location outside campus with a lot of experiences together, and of course, food and drinks go along. But this year, this wasn't possible. This had to be transformed to an online event. And what we decided, it would be horrible if we would have it in 2 days in a row online, because the effect, the impact, the results would not be the ones that we want. So we decided to split it into 11 subgroup sessions, where various topics ranging from the evaluation of the program to the different courses, talking about strategic management issues, looking into the online, offline, blended version of provision of the program, were taken into consideration. And each and every session was facilitated by a different team member. And that brought us a lot. You can see here a little bit of an impression of how it looks like when it was conducted offline. And this is also how it looked like a little bit this year with one of the murals that we were looking into, discussing one of our blocks into the block structure. So yes, it brought us a lot of, again, learning points and lessons learned to take further. Yes, it is valuable to do an annual evaluation. This allows us to make really agreements to commit ourselves for the future improvement. It is also very, very valuable to do that for a course, for a specific thematic issue, and to really see what works and what doesn't so that we can exchange experiences. It was very valuable, and it has always been, because we've been running that for many years, more than 7, I think now, to include alumni, to include stakeholders of the industry into our heydays, as we call them. And the transformation from offline event to multiple online events had a lot of benefit, because it gave us a lot more time to digest, to process, to get to decisions which would not be speeded up within the 2 days when time is again, of course, lacking. Now we spent a lot more time. I have to admit it was a little bit of a crazy endeavor, because if you calculate 11 sessions multiplied by 2 hours, and on top of that, the preparation each and every session took prior and post the event, you can imagine. But we have really summarized results. We have very much profound output, which is amazing. And of course, the team building factor of an online event would never be the same as an offline event. And we have, of course, dreams for the future. We are now busy with management of developing a new platform where we can introduce our learning community far better into an online format. And we need new technology to ease, to facilitate communication between the students on campus with the students all over the world, because within our classroom, we have 70% international students. These are the impressions of what we hope to be soon having at the campus. For now, this was only on TV in a show which is far more costly than an educational program can allow itself, but we aim big. And if I may move then to the summary, also looking into the time and the insights, takeaways that we can have, then it is very important, of course, to summon them up into 4 specific principles. First, interaction is paramount in education, because it does raise the level of participation of the students, of their involvement, of their commitment. Online interaction, indeed, is far more difficult than the offline one, but it is even more necessary for the student motivation. And the interaction does not only refer to interaction between simply the students and the teachers, but it involves all these different players that we mentioned, including alumni, including industry and stakeholders. And what is very important to say at the end, it is not so much a matter of technology, but first of all, a matter of having the interaction mindset. If we do have that, then there are plenty of opportunities, there are plenty of tools, but a tool is nothing without us being able to be on top of it and actually delivering the why behind each and everything that we are doing. So if we have to ask the question, when is it time for interaction and engagement? We have to say it is always. So thank you very much. And I would like now to move to the point of where we can have some questions and more questions, because I'm sure that the Q&A is full of different experiences. So I would like to kindly give the floor to Ligia, if possible, and myself to have a look into the Q&A. And in the meantime, I will also post some links for you where you can also give us maybe a little bit more interaction. Thank you. Ligia, please, the floor is yours.
Okay, I'm just putting myself there. Let's see if I can see myself. Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Lilia. Thank you very much, Margot. It was really, really amazing and interesting to see what we have done so far about interaction and all the tips and tricks. Thank you very much. I hope everyone has also enjoyed it. I'm sure they did. Muchas gracias, Lilia. Voy a hablar ahora en español un poquito. Vamos a iniciar las sesiones de preguntas y respuestas. We will like tackle some questions. Gracias a los moderadores. Voy a intentar seguir acá las preguntas. Gracias por haberlo puesto también en inglés. Voy a intentar hacer el puente acá, la moderación, en los próximos 10 minutos. So Lilia and Margot, some questions that come here are related to, for instance, do you hear me? Which tools, how to provide more focused information to students and still facilitate their learning? There was also something related to what was the difference between knowledge transfer and instruction? Maybe we can start with this one.
Maybe I can start with the last question on knowledge transfer and instruction and the difference between them. Instruction has to do with instructions regarding an assignment that you give to your students, and knowledge transfer is more like doing a lecture and providing new knowledge to the students. I hope that is clear.
No sé si los moderadores pueden traducir acá la respuesta, por favor. If you can just, I'm trying also to to get back to the questions. So they say. Let me see here other questions. Help me also moderate.
Yeah, if I may as well, I also see here a question, how to motivate our students. Is there any difference? And also those teachers who do not have any knowledge in didactics, in pedagogy, in andragogy, what is then a good way for them to be motivated, etc.? And that is a very relevant one. I mean, this is also a process of learning for all of us. And if I would look also into our lecturers here, and I'm originally, for example, from Bulgaria, where we do not have that much of an elaborate system when it comes to didactics. But this is also something that more or less you learn on the go. And what could be a prerequisite and what could be the ideal case scenario, as it happens, for example, in Austria, in the Netherlands, in Spain, is to have these compulsory didactic courses for the educators. And they should not be, because in some countries, as in Finland, they are 2 years long. But if they would be into small sessions grouped per the specifics of what can be actually tackled by the specific professor in the specific field, then they can be very valuable, because then you really make the estimate of how much do you facilitate and how much do you give instructions and transmit knowledge.
Thank you. Lilia, they also mentioned here in research area, is there any specific tools to manage the class session? Any suggestion?
Yes, this is also a very good one. And for this one, allow me to also bring you back after this webinar via the Eventbrite, because we have all the attendees contacts, a whole file with all the different online research tools that we are using, because it is not just one. There are specific tools we use for interviewing. There are specific tools we use for creative sessions. There are specific tools for processing the data, transcription, and etc. So we have made a whole collection. We have made even on Teams a team for all these online research tools. So we will be getting back to you with a clear summary on those.
Thank you. They also mentioned how long, because you mentioned some examples of lectures. I think it was in your slide 27 or 26, when we were talking about differences, knowledge transfer, interaction, and some formats where you were switching different methods of instruction, so to say. How long these classes normally take? There were some questions about it. That these formats require synchronic access to online platforms, and because sometimes it's a challenge to their context when everything should be synchronic or so many online platforms should be used.
That is very true. That is very true. This is something we have also as a challenge at our university. For example, we have already the license for Teams, but still, we see that quite a lot of our lecturers use Zoom and anything else, you name it. But this doesn't mean that we do not have one central one, which is Teams. And yes, you're very right. When we gave this with the different components, this can refer to classes from 2 to 8 hours a day. And it is not necessary. So this is also the beauty of it. And I remember from the last webinars, there was also the question of how much the students value the pre-recorded lectures. And sometimes they are not willing to attend, but basically to watch, is this a good way? And yes, given the situation, given the specifics of the university and where it is located, and we know both in Chile and Peru, it is not that everybody lives in the capital and it is so easily commuting, not at all the case. And sometimes in the capital, commuting might be even more difficult than it would be in the countryside. So in that sense, having all these possibilities of pre-recording, watching it at their own time, and coming back at the central point where the interaction on a platform that should be chosen for shouldn't be just at a random putting tools together without any meaning. And that is really something that would be very contextual. We cannot come up here with the best formula on that.
Thank you. There are also a question, I don't know if it fits properly now, but it was asked, what would be the tools for evaluation or best tools for evaluation law courses? I don't know if you have any.
Now this is also something that is a work in progress, I have to say, currently at our university, because we do have now the online proctoring. And I remember this was also something that was shared last time, and that for huge groups is really very valuable. But when it comes to smaller groups of students or one-on-one examination, then basically channels such as Teams and also with the provision of software, which would be guaranteeing in one way or another the check on plagiarism, etc. We also have a platform, a learning management system, because I have to be careful. I know that both Carlos's are professionals on platforms when I say platform. But when it comes to a learning management system, we have a one on which when the students would submit, and we do it even nowadays, we take home exams, everything can be properly checked. Of course, you can never check 100%, because even though we shorten the time, even though we have our ways of really asking questions that are not so easy to copy paste, still things can happen. So there is a work in progress, but we have now since the 13th of March, when this intelligent lockdown was announced, already a team of 25 people busy with all these forms of evaluation. Yeah, how to take them.
And maybe I would try the last one, that are some also combining some of them, that it's okay. It was also difficult to engage sometimes the students, and in sense that how to guide them really as a facilitator, not giving so much information, but at the same time in an easier way that they can understand and follow. That was one. And the other is how engage our colleagues in this new way to learn and to teach.
Yeah, thank you, Ligia. These are two very interesting ones. Yeah, about the engaging of colleagues, I will allow myself to quote a great educational program director we have on the entire level of the university, who said, the moment this thing happened with the crisis, 25% were really embracing it. 50% said, yeah, no way out, I have to do it. And 25%, we don't know even what they are doing. So in that sense, I can tell you that there is no formula. Certain people will simply find a different, maybe, passion than doing education, especially if we would go now more towards blended and online. But those people who are the ones that take the initiative, that take the energy, I would say go along with them. And then the more the other 50% who are still on board and who still do it because they don't have any other choice, they will see the value. And I think this is more or less what is also happening at our university and also in the different programs we teach, because for some of us, and I also have to tell you, I'm not the one who is on a fan of everything doing online or etc. or learning on a daily basis a new tool, but still, I really see the moment you see it coming back because of the student and his or her engagement, then it is very rewarding. And I think especially if you record something and then this can be reused and you don't have to answer again 100 times to the same question, it's fantastic. Which is also going back to the question, and I know I have to finish, it is how to guide the students, how to facilitate them and not to give, because sometimes they are comfortably sitting and waiting for us to do everything. And I think relating what we do to the actual world and really showing them what that would mean for them in practice. And now I think we can do it far better than ever, because what is happening outside is actually a reality. Before, they could easily plan what would the world look like. Now nobody can plan. And I think this kind of uncertainty will also give them new types of shoes. And these new types of shoes, once they have them on, they will feel more the urgency to actually do something.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I think it's time to move. I will switch to Spanish. If I may, to close. Thank you and muchas gracias, Lilia. Muchas gracias, Margo. Lo que vamos a hacer y que se propuso también Lili y Margo, las preguntas que quedaron abiertas, que se vamos a poder después hacer alguna respuesta y enviarles por el mismo correo que se registraron en Eventbrite. Les voy a compartir acá en el chat para los que quieren pedir el certificado, el enlace para el certificado. También nos gustaría que evalúen la sesión. Lo vamos a pasar también a esos mismos enlaces por el correo que se registraron en Eventbrite. Pero acá les dejo los enlaces para el certificado y enlace para el formulario de evaluación de ese webinario, que para nosotros es muy importante también para poder planificar, hacer mejorías necesarias. Muchas gracias a todos y todas, principalmente a nuestras formadoras hoy día, Lilia y Margo, una vez más, por estar acá. Nos acompañaron también acá en el backstage Carlos, los dos Carlos de la Universidad Carlos III Madrid. Estuvieron acá con nosotros también backstage. Muchas gracias. Gracias a todas las universidades, todos los profesores y profesoras que participaron. Seguimos en contacto y lo que necesiten también pueden contactar sus contactos desde la universidad, que nos pueden encaminar preguntas o algunas dudas que puedan tener. Así que muchas gracias. Que tengan un buen día en Chile y Perú. Acá ya vamos terminando el día Y muchos saludos de mi parte y de todos del equipo Innovat. Muchas gracias.